This video is to accompany the Cisco Netacad Switching, Routing, and Wireless Essentials course. This video is Module 4, Inter-VLAN Routing. In this video, we're going to look at four objectives: Inter-VLAN Routing Operation, Router on a Stick, Inter-VLAN Routing, Inter-VLAN Routing using a Layer 3 switch, and Troubleshooting Inter-VLAN Routing. 4.1, Inter-VLAN Routing Operation. So what is inter-VLAN routing? VLANs are used to segment switched layer 2 networks for a number of different reasons, but regardless of the reason, host in one VLAN cannot communicate with host in another VLAN unless there's a router or a layer 3 switch to provide routing services. So inter-VLAN routing is the process of forwarding network traffic from one VLAN to another VLAN. And there are three inter-VLAN routing options. You have legacy routing. This is a legacy solution and it does not scale well. You have router on a stick. This is an acceptable solution for a small to medium sized network. And then you have the layer 3 switch using switched virtual interfaces or SVIs. And this is the most scalable solution for medium to large companies. The legacy inter-VLAN routing, it was the first routing solution and it relied on using a router with multiple Ethernet interfaces. Each router interface was connected to a switch port in different VLANs, and the router interfaces served as the default gateways to the localhost on a VLAN subnet. And legacy inter-VLAN routing using physical interfaces works, but it does have significant limitations. It's not scalable because routers have a limited number of physical interfaces, and it requires one physical router interface per VLAN, and it quickly exhausts the physical interface capacity of any router. And there is a note here that this method of inter-VLAN routing is no longer implemented in switched networks, and it's only included here for explanation purposes in case you come across it. The router on a stick VLAN routing, it's a method that overcomes the limitation of the legacy VLAN routing. It only requires one physical Ethernet interface to route traffic between multiple VLANs, and a Cisco iOS router Ethernet interface is configured as an 802.1Q trunk and connected to a trunk port on a layer 2 switch. And specifically, the router interface is configured using sub-interfaces to identify routable VLANs. So the configured sub-interfaces are software-based virtual interfaces, and each one is associated with a single Ethernet interface or physical Ethernet interface, and the sub-interfaces are configured in a software on the router. So each sub-interface is independently configured with an IP address and a VLAN assignment, and then the sub-interfaces are configured for different subnets that correspond to their VLAN assignment, and this facilitates logical routing. But when VLAN tag traffic enters the router interface, it's forwarded to the VLAN sub-interface. And after a routing decision is made based on the destination IP, the router determines the exit interface. And if the exit interface is configured as an 802.1Q, the data frames are VLAN tagged with the new VLAN and sent back out the physical interface. And there's a note here that the router on a stick method of an inter-VLAN routing does not scale but beyond 50 VLANs. So that's the limitation there. Now, when we do inter-VLAN routing on a layer 3 switch, this is the modern method of performing inter-VLAN routing, and you use a layer 3 switch and switched virtual interfaces or SVIs. An SVI is a virtual interface that is configured on a layer 3 switch as shown in the figure below. And there's a note here that the layer 3 switch is also called a multi-layer switch as it operates at layer 2 and layer 3. However, in this course, we're only going to use the term layer 3 switch. Inter-VLAN SVIs are created the same way that the management VLAN interface is configured. The SVI is created for a VLAN that exists on the switch. And although virtual, the SVI performs the same functions for the VLAN as a router interface would. Specifically, it provides layer 3 processing for packets that are sent to or from all switch ports associated with that VLAN. And there are some advantages of using a layer 3 switch for inter-VLAN routing. They're much faster than router on a stick because everything is hardware switched. Switched and routed. There's no need for external links from the switch to the router for routing. They're not limited to one link because layer 2 Ethernet channels can be used as trunk lines between the switches to increase bandwidth. Latency is also lower because data does not need to leave the switch in order to be routed to a different network. They're more commonly deployed in a campus LAN than routers, and the only disadvantage is that Layer 3 switches are more expensive. 4.2, router on a stick, inter-VLAN routing. Now, when we're talking about a router on a stick scenario, in the figure to the right, the R1 gigabit Ethernet 001 interface is connected to the Switch 1 fast Ethernet 05 port. So the Switch 1 fast Ethernet port is connected to the S2 fast Ethernet port. And so these trunk lines are required to forward traffic within and between the VLANs. To route between the VLANs, the R1 gigabit Ethernet interface is logically divided into three sub-interfaces, as it's shown in the table. The table also shows the three VLANs that will be configured on the switches. And you need to assume that R1, S1, and S2 have initial basic configurations. And currently, PC1 and PC2 cannot ping each other because they're on separate networks. Only Switch 1 and Switch 2 can ping each other, but they are not unreachable by PC1 and PC2 because they're also on different networks. To enable devices to ping each other, the switches must be configured with VLANs and trunking, and the router must be configured for the inter-VLAN routing. So there's four steps we need to complete. We need to create and name the VLANs. We need to create the management interface. We need to configure the access ports, and then we need to configure the trunking ports. So the configuration for S2 is similar to S1. And you can look at the commands here. We have VLAN 10, we named it, we exited out VLAN 20, we named it management. And then we set the interface VLAN 99, added the IP address, told it to no shutdown, set the default IP gateway, set the switch port mode to access, did the no shutdown, set the interface, switch port mode for trunking, did the no shutdown, exited, ended, and then it should be up and running. The R1 sub-interface configuration, the router on a stick method, does require you to create a sub-interface for each VLAN to be routed. A sub-interface is creating using the interface command on the global configuration mode. The sub-interface syntax is the physical interface followed by a period and a sub-interface number. And although it's not required, it's customary to match the sub-interface number with the VLAN number just for ease of being able to tell what goes to what in your network. So each sub-interface is then configured with the following two commands: the encapsulation, and this command configures the sub-interface to respond to 802.1q encapsulated traffic from the specified VLAN, and the native keyword option is only appended to set the native VLAN to something other than VLAN 1. And then we use the IP address to set the IP address. That configures the IPv4 address on the sub-interface, and this typically serves as the default gateway for the identified VLAN. And then you just repeat the process for each VLAN to be routed, and each router sub-interface must be assigned an IP address on a unique subnet for routing to occur. And then when all the sub-interfaces have been created, you enable the physical interface using the no shutdown command, and then if the physical interface is disabled, all the sub-interfaces are disabled. And these are the commands that you would put in. You can pause your screen right here to see these. Then we need to verify connectivity between our PC1 and PC2. The router on a stick configuration is complete after the switch trunk and the router sub-interfaces have been configured. And so from a host, you can verify connectivity using the ping command. You can also use the IP config to verify your host and local IP address. The router on a stick inter VLAN routing and verification, you can use the show IP route, the show IP interface brief, the show interfaces, or the show interfaces trunk. 4.3, inter VLAN routing using layer 3 switches. The inter VLAN routing using the router on a stick method, it's simple to implement for a small to medium sized organization. However, large enterprises require a faster, more scalable method to provide inter VLAN routing. So enterprise campus LANs use layer 3 switches to provide the inter-VLAN routing, and layer 3 switches use hardware-based switching to achieve higher packet processing rates than routers, and layer 3 switches are also commonly implemented in enterprise distribution layer wiring closets. Now the capabilities of a layer 3 switch include the ability to do the following: route from one VLAN to another using multiple switched SVIs. It can convert a layer 2 switch port to a layer 3 interface or a routed port. And a routed port is similar to a physical interface on a Cisco iOS router. And then it also provides inter-VLAN routing. Layer 3 switches use the SVIs, and they're configured using the same interface VLAN with your ID command, used to create the management SVI on a Layer 2 switch. And a Layer 3 SVI must be created for each of the routable VLANs. Here we're showing a Layer 3 switch scenario, and the Layer 3 switch D1 is connected to two hosts on different VLANs. PC1 is in VLAN 10, and PC2 is in VLAN 20, and the Layer 3 switch will provide inter-VLAN routing services to the two hosts. Now, the Layer 3 switch configuration, you can complete the following steps to configure switch 1 with VLANs and trunking. So you create the VLANs in the example, create the SVI VLAN interfaces, and the IP address configured will serve as the default gateway. You then configure the access ports and assign appropriate ports to the required VLAN, and then you enable IP routing using the IP routing global config command to allow traffic to be exchanged between VLANs 10 and 20. And this command must be configured to enable the routing on a Layer 3 switch for V4. Now, to get verification, the inter-VLAN routing using a Layer 3 switch is simpler to configure than a router on a stick method. And after the configuration is complete, the config can be verified by testing connectivity by using the ping command. And it's also a good idea to check your IP addressing with ipconfig on the Windows host command, and then verify the connectivity using the ping Windows command. And if you get a successful ping, it will confirm that your inter-VLAN routing is operating. Now, routing on a Layer 3 switch, if the VLANs are to be reachable by other Layer 3 devices, they must be advertised using a static or dynamic routing. So to enable routing on a Layer 3 switch, a routed port must be configured. And so a routed port is created on a Layer 3 switch by disabling the switch port feature on a Layer 2 port that is connected to another Layer 3 device, and then configuring the no switch port interface configuration command on that port converts it to a Layer 3 interface. And then the interface can be configured with an IPv4 configuration to connect to a router or another Layer 3 switch. And here we have a scenario on a Layer 3 switch. The previously configured D1 Layer 3 switch is now connected to Router 1. So Router 1 and D1 are both in an open shortest path first, or OSPF, routing protocol domain. And then we're going to assume that inter-VLAN has been successfully implemented and tested. And then there's a note with OSPF. The routing configuration is covered in another course. Not this course, it's in the next course. And in this module, though, OSPF configuration commands will be given to you in all the activities and assessments. And it's not required that you understand the configuration in order to enable OSPF at this point on the Layer 3 switches. You'll cover that in the next course. 4.4, troubleshooting the inter-VLAN routing. So there's some common VLAN issues or inter-VLAN issues. There are a number of different reasons why the configuration may not work, and all are usually related to connectivity issues. So first you want to check the physical layer to resolve any issues. Make sure the network cables are plugged in properly. So, and I've had this happen to me before. I was trying to diagnose a network, spent about 15 minutes trying to look at everything. Was the drivers wrong? Went around to the back of the computer and the cable wasn't plugged in. So don't, you know, always check the layer one first. And then if the connections are correct, then use the list in the table for other common reasons. You might have a missing VLAN. So you might need to create or recreate the VLAN if it doesn't exist. You can do the show VLAN brief, show interfaces switch port, and then use the ping command. You also check your switch trunk port issues. Ensure your trunks are configured properly. And then ensure the trunk is a trunk port and enabled. Then check your switch access port. You want to assign correct VLANs to the access port. Ensure the port is an access port and enabled. And then make sure that the host is not incorrectly configured in the wrong subnet. And then check your router configuration issues. The router subinterface V4 addresses might be incorrectly configured, so check that. And then check the router subinterface that it's assigned to the VLAN ID. And you can check that using the show IP interface brief and then the show interfaces. These are some examples of inter-VLAN routing problems that can be covered in more detail. And this topology will be used for all these issues. You can set this up on your packet tracer and go through these on your own. And you'll be doing that as well in the course when we teach this. You'll have packet tracer labs that we'll do as we're going through the course. An inter-VLAN connectivity issue could be caused by a missing VLAN, and the VLAN could be missing if it was not created properly, or it was accidentally deleted, or it's not allowed on the trunk line. So when a VLAN is deleted, any ports assigned to that VLAN become inactive, and they remain associated with the VLAN and thus inactive until you assign them to a new VLAN or recreate the missing VLAN. So recreating the missing VLAN would automatically reassign the host to it, and you can use the show interface and give the interface name, switch port command to verify the VLAN membership of the port. You can have switch trunk port issues. Another issue includes misconfiguration of switch ports. So in the legacy inter-VLAN solution, this could be caused when the connecting router port is not assigned to the correct VLAN. But also with the router on a stick solution, the most common cause is a misconfigured trunk port. So you can verify with the show interface trunk and then do the show run config interface X. You can also have switch access port issues. So when this problem is suspected with the switch, use verification commands to examine the configuration and then correct any problems. So a common indicator is the PC having the correct address configuration or incorrect. Check the IP address, check the subnet mask, check your default gateway. But if you're unable to ping its default gateway, you can then go to the switch and do the show VLAN brief, show interface X switch port, or show run config interface X command to verify the VLAN assignments. You can also have router configuration issues. On the route on a stick configuration problems, you can verify the subinterface status using the show IP interface brief, and you can verify which VLANs each of the subinterface is on, and you can do the show interface command. It's useful for generating a lot of information. The command output can be reduced using the iOS command filters. And in the example below, we use the include keyword to identify only lines containing the letters gig or 8021Q. So what did we learn in this module? You can pause the screen here, but we talked about inter-VLAN routing, about using commands to troubleshoot. We also looked at issues on inter-VLAN routing, including misconfigured switch ports and proper port assignments. And then also with router on a stick solution, the most common issue being a misconfigured trunk. And then we also looked at commands to verify using the ping or show IP interface brief.